Welcome back to our continuing walk through the Genesis 1 creation days. If you haven't seen the previous videos in this series, make sure you go watch those first, because we are going literally day by day, or is it literal? But we're taking each of the creation days at a time in this video series and going through Genesis chapter 1, really digging down into the text, looking what it says, what it doesn't say, some of the underlying concepts, the Hebrew language concepts, literary characteristics. So if you appreciate these type of deep dive Bible studies and want to see more of them, then do us a huge favor and click the subscribe button and the notifications icon if you've not already done so. That's the biggest way you can support this online teaching ministry, as well as the other ministries of Disciple Dojo, such as our Refugee Jitsu Outreach here in Charlotte for local kids from the refugee, immigrant, and lower income populations that would not otherwise have access to all of the good things that martial arts training instills in young people. Another one is our community for single Christians called the Grown-Ups Table. I just got back from a retreat at the beach with 50 new friends that I met, single adults from all across the country. We got together and we spent a weekend hanging out at the beach, having fun, playing games, getting to know each other, and also doing a study through the book of Ecclesiastes, which hopefully we'll be diving into here on the channel as well in the coming months. So along with this YouTube channel, these are a couple of other things that Disciple Dojo does as part of this ministry to equip, engage, and empower God's people, taking them deeper in their biblical discipleship and their walk with the Lord. If that interests you, if you want to see more of it, in addition to subscribing to this channel, we would love for you to become a Disciple Dojo donor. Everything we do is entirely donor funded. We depend on our donors to support this ministry, and we just trust that God will provide through people who like what we're doing and they want to see more of it. So if that's you, check the link that's going to be posted in the video description below for how you can become a monthly dojo donor at whatever amount, a couple of dollars a month, a couple of $100 a month. If you're looking for a way to use some of what God's given you to help bless other people in tangible ways, this is one way that you can do so, and it's greatly appreciated. So with that being said, let's get back into Genesis chapter 1, and let's look at day 5. Now to recap, days 1 through 4 we've covered so far. Day 1, God created the day and the night, Yom and Laila. Then in day 2, he put into place the Rakia, which separated the waters above from the waters below. He called that Rakia the sky. So we have sky and we have the waters. Then on day 3, dry land appeared. And once dry land appeared, God made another creative act, bringing forth vegetation. And as we saw, having the land bring forth vegetation rather than him doing it directly. So creation, and then giving creation itself the ability to bring forth new creation. Then in day 4, in our last video, we saw that God puts into the Rakia of the sky, the sun and the moon and also the stars, but didn't call them that. He called them the greater light, the big light, and the lesser light or the little light. And we saw how subversive that was to some of the popular understandings in the ancient Near East of what the sun, moon, and stars actually were to Israel's neighbors. So now we come to Yom Chamishi. Verse 20 reads, God said, "Let the waters swarm with swarming souls of life." Now this is a woodenly literal translation of these two Hebrew words, nefesh chaya. And we have a video here at Superhero Seminary where our esteemed faculty member, Professor T'Challa, aka the Black Panther, talks about why the Bible refers to animals using this phrase, nefesh chaya. And most translations render this souls of life. They interpret it into English in a way that makes more sense. We would say living creatures. And nefesh, that word for soul, has to do with breathing, with breath. So everything that has nefesh chayat, everything that has a soul of life, the breath of life, there's not an exact English equivalent to this phrase, but it will be used elsewhere in scripture to talk about living things. And it is noteworthy that the Hebrew word for soul, nefesh, is found in this phrase that's used to describe these first living beings outside of the plants. So God said, let the waters swarm with swarming nefesh chaya, souls of life, living creatures. And I'm translating it specifically swarm with swarming because that preserves the links between the verb yishratsu and then the adjective sheretz. So let them swarm, or some translations say team. Swarming is just I go with swarm because it's easier. I don't use the word team very often in my own daily vocabulary, but same thing, swarming, teaming. So let them swarm the waters with swarming souls of life, nefesh chaya. And then the next line, and flying creatures will fly over the land, or let flying creatures fly over the land. And that preserves, again, the same words used. And ulf, this is the word for flying creature, bird, but it could also include other things that fly. Ya'ofeith. Ulf ya'ofeith. So let flying creatures fly al ha'aretz, upon or over or above the land. Al panei rakia, upon or over or above the face of the rakia, hashamayim, of heaven. So God is speaking into being two types of things, things in the waters and things that fly across the rakia that live on the land. So verse 21, God created the great tananim. We're going to come back and talk about this word here in just a second. And every living crawling soul, the nefesh chaya, that swarms the waters according to their types, and every winged creature according to its type. God saw that it was good. Now this verse, 21, God created the great taninim. I just left this Hebrew word. It's right here. You can see it, hataninim. And this is translated different ways in different translations. Take a look. So if you read like the JPS, God created the great sea monsters. That's how they translate taninim godolim. Godol just means great or big. So this word, sea monsters, JPS. King James, God created great whales. But the New King James, you can see right below it, they use the word creatures. So what are taninim? It's a plural. So what are these great taninim? What are they? Are they monsters, sea monsters? Are they whales? Are they just sea creatures? NIV says creatures. New Revised and Revised go with sea monsters. ESV, sea creatures. CSB, sea creatures. New American Standard, sea monsters. Legacy Standard, sea monsters. New Living, sea creatures. Common English Bible, great sea animals. So where did King James get whales from? That seems pretty specific. Well, actually, back here in the Geneva Bible, it translated it as great whales. And in the Tyndale translation, way back, great whales with some funky Tyndale spelling. Now the Septuagint, when they translated this verse into Greek, they translated it with ta kete. And you can see at the bottom of the screen, kete comes from the noun ketas. And so if you open the, we'll just open up LEH, Septuagint Lexicon. You can see over here, here's ketas. And it's used right here, Genesis 1:21. And it is sea monster, huge fish, because it's found in Jonah chapter 2 in the Septuagint, even though the Hebrew word is different. And cetacea, or cetacea. This is where we get the English word cetacean, which is used to describe things in the whale family. And so I'm not an expert on the history of the English translations or the Septuagint for that matter, but I'm pretty sure this is where the term whales got brought into English from this Greek word that we get the word cetacean from, ketas. But regardless, the Hebrew word is taninim. And if we open up Hallett, the Hebrew Aramaic lexicon of the Old Testament, to tanin, this is the singular of taninim, and we see a couple of definitions. Sea monster, sea dragon. And it gives us right there, Genesis 1:21. Or just dragon in general. That's how it's used in Jeremiah 51. Or serpent. This is actually the term used in Exodus 7. In the encounter where Aaron throws down his staff and then the magicians throw down their staves, and Aaron's staff eats the other staffs of the magicians, it is referred to with the Hebrew word tanin. And this was also the term that was used to describe crocodiles, because in that part of the world, those were the largest sea monsters. If you've ever run into a saltwater crocodile, you know that's a pretty monstrous looking thing, and it's big. So Taninim is a sea serpent, a sea monster. It was used to describe crocodiles or mythical sea monsters like Leviathan, which would also characterize as a Tanin. And so in Genesis, what we have is God created the great Taninim, the great sea monsters. All of those big scary things in the ocean or things that were seen as forces of chaos. Remember, in Mesopotamian and in Egyptian mythology, cosmology, the Tanin was the rival of the gods of creation. So Marduk had to slay Tiamat. Well, Tiamat was the sea serpent, the chaos dragon. Same thing in Egyptian literature. The sea serpent is slain and then creation can come about. But in the Genesis account, once again, just like we saw in the last video with the sun, the moon, and the stars, Genesis is de-deifying these aspects of creation. And Job is actually going to pick up on this. At the end of Job, when God comes and starts talking to Job and says, you know, can you pull up Leviathan with a fish hook? He's going to reference this same concept that even the mighty Leviathan or the terrifying behemoth, these images that were ubiquitous in the ancient world, denoting forces of chaos, rivals to the various gods. What we see in Genesis 1 is the author of Genesis 1 is saying, these are just creatures that God himself brings into being. And not just the scary, majestic things that swim in the waters, but also the majestic things that fly across the sky. Every winged creature, according to its type. These are elements. It's just elements of creation. That's the message that day five is communicating. All of these things, once more, the things that humanity wants to worship and that Israel's neighbors worshiped, what Genesis is saying is these are just aspects of creation. They're not divine. We're not subservient to them. We're certainly not to pray to them or to sacrifice to them. And then look what God does to the flying things and the things that swarm in the waters and the great Tanim, what are seen in other religions as chaos serpents or symbols of rival deities. Look what God says, verse 22, God blessed them, saying, be fruitful, increase and fill the waters and the seas, and flying creatures, increase in the land. You see God taking delight in even the things that terrify other ancient peoples. God is blessing. He is giving these creatures the mandate to go forth, to multiply, to spread, to fill the creation that he's placed them in. And then verse 23, there was evening, there was morning, Yom Chamishi, a fifth day. So the sequence continues. On day five, Yom Chamishi, we have the fish and the birds. Or you could say swimming things or swarming things and flying things or winged things. But as we saw with the categories on day three of the different types of plants, the author of Genesis isn't giving us all of the species that God's created exhaustively. He's giving us things that live and crawl and swarm in the waters and things that fly on wings, fly across the sky, that live in the land. It's not exhaustive. Genesis isn't giving us the tree of life in all of its detail. There are creatures that, do they fit this category or do they fit another category? Like a platypus. Platypus swims in the water. The waters teem with platypuses, platypi. I don't know the plural of that. So would they be included in this or would they be included in the next day when we see the wild animals brought into play? Well, Genesis doesn't give us that detail. We have to decide how do we interpret what Genesis does give us with what we see in the world around us. What about bats? Bats aren't birds, but they do fly across the sky and live in the land. So are bats created on this day? Or would bats be part of the things that are created in the subsequent day when more of the furry type things are brought about? What about dinosaurs? Where do they fit into play? Are they part of the great Taninim? Is Genesis referencing dinosaurs in this creation account? Is that what Job's behemoth and Leviathan were? Some Christians say yes. Others say no. Dinosaurs were extinct long before humans ever came on the scene. How do we fit the two together? If this interests you and you want to unpack this a little bit more, check out our free video series here on the channel called The Bible and Science, Friends or Foes. We walk through Genesis 1, the literary background, and in particular, we look at how scientific approaches have read Genesis 1. But keep in mind, regardless of where you end up landing with your interpretation of Genesis 1 and science, keep in mind the covenantal language that Genesis 1 is filled with, that God is speaking in terms that his people, as his covenant people, understand, that relates to them. This God blessing them and saying, be fruitful and increase and fill the waters and the seas and increase in the land, this is going to get repeated. It's going to get repeated to Adam. It's going to get repeated to Noah. Abraham's offspring are going to be said in Exodus to fill the land. So there are biblical themes, there are theological themes that Genesis is trying to portray, and it's not trying to answer 19th and 20th and 21st century questions of science, biology, anthropology, paleontology. Those are all questions that we modern readers have, not questions that Genesis's original audience had. So we want to know what the text says and means and what it has to say to us today. We have to exegete the text. We have to say, what did it say and mean to them? And then once we figure that out, then we can ask, okay, now how does that principle, how does that concept, how does that meaning apply to my life today as a member of God's covenant people? So by Yom Chamishi, day 5, this is what we have. We have one more creation day, and then we have one final day left before the chapter draws to a close. So stay tuned for the next video when we look at Yom Hashishi, the 6th day. Spoiler alert, it's going to be pretty important. But until then, once again, if you haven't already subscribed to this channel, we would greatly appreciate it if you would. That's all for now. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next time at Disciple Dojo. And as always, keep training.